good to be in God's house this morning. What an awesome time. Can we give a round of applause for our worship team? What did they do a great job? We have a great place to be here. And I am excited to bring God's word. And man, Pastor asked me a few weeks ago to preach on this day. So you get honored to hear my voice bringing God's word. And I'm excited because God laid something huge on my heart. Can I be honest with you? What he's laid on my heart this morning is, I think, is part of everybody's life. It's part of everybody in this place. You can't deny it all you want. Some of us are like, well, this word's not for me, so I'm just going to check out. Well, let me tell you right now, before you check out, try to get on the face, a book of faces, this word is for you. God laid something on my heart for you, every single one of us. I was challenged when I was preparing this word this morning. And so, man, a few weeks ago, this new album dropped. Anybody, does people buy music still? CDs? Anybody buy CDs still? Come on. Where are my people? Yes. The CDs are still cool. I don't care how much MP3 and iTunes try to take over. And the new album dropped a few weeks back, and it was the Gospel Elevation album. And I've been listening to that so religiously. I probably shouldn't, or should, because it's good music. But I'm a person that loves to listen to music. And when a new album comes out, I'll probably listen to it 200 times before I get sick of it. Anybody like that? Can anybody relate to that? Come on. Come on, let's be honest this morning. We're going to participate. That means we get to have a little raising of hands. I'm going to ask some questions. And I think about this, and I think about music, and I look back at my life, and I realize music's always been a part of my life. I may not be the worship leader on Sunday morning, but music has always had an impact in my life. I still remember the first concert I went to. Can anybody guess which concert that as a 14-year-old teenage boy went to for the first time? Can anybody guess? Well, I'll guess. Who? Miley Cyrus? No! That was y'all's pastor right there accusing me of Miley Cyrus. I can't even answer that. It was actually Skillet. Anybody know Skillet? Yeah. Some of my little metal bangers, yeah, that's Skillet. Yeah, Skillet. Disciple, Decipher Down. It was at my high school. So these bands were playing in my high school. And here I am, 14-year-old, junior high student, kind of whatever. And I was like, ooh, I've been listening to Skillet on my phone. And I think I'm going to go see them in concert. And y'all, let me tell you. First off, if you've never been to a concert, I'm going to warn you right now. The first time you go to the concert, you got to know it's going to be loud. But here's the deal. Skillet's not just a Christian band. They are a Christian rock band. Rock. Emphasis on the rock. There's a lot of drums, a lot of heavy guitar. Some of you like still listen to that music. I listen to that music. It gets me pumped up, workout music. And here I am. And here's my face, y'all. First intro. Every rock band has a cool intro that goes into their set. They go in and have these really light shows and all this stuff. And this is my face. Like, I found where I belonged. This was awesome. They got to start playing, and I started screaming because I knew the song, so I started singing out the lyrics. Yes, yes, I'm singing this song, and I started doing the headbanging. Some of you have been to Journey. How many have gone to Journey in concert? You get a little headbanging going. You wake up the next morning, your neck's sore, lets you know it's a good concert when your neck's sore, your body's sore. And I jumped around at my first concert, and let me tell you, I got addicted going to concerts. I'm like, so when's the next concert? Can anybody remember going to a concert? Some of you, it is Miley Cyrus. How many have been to see Miley Cyrus? Yours pastor's wife is the one who's gone to see Miley Cyrus. Some of you have seen Journey. I know, I've talked to many of you that have went to see Journey and some of those nice 80s rock bands. And it's an experience that I am so amazed with the concert. The pyrotechnics, you know, when they had the fire, it's always 10 times better. Especially when you're in the front row and lose your eyebrows. It's always better in the front row. And so, I had a question when I was reflecting and looking at a concert. It's, we go to these concerts and we jump and we shout, we scream, we lose our voice, we get the next tour from headbanging. Yeah, we get all that for a performer on a stage, but when it comes to worshiping our Savior, we're silent. We can't even lift our hands in church. I know. I convicted myself. Because I'm the kid that's jumping around at a concert. I'm the kid that's having a great time. But when it comes to worship, well, that's just not me. That's not my style. No. Austin, worship the Lord, the creator of the world. We can jump, sing, and shout for a performer on a stage, but we can't give all the praise to the creator of the universe. I was challenged thinking about this message, and we're going to walk through a lot of scripture because I think scripture is the foundation of our faith. Scripture is the foundation of our faith. So we're going to walk through scripture, and we're going to walk through one of my favorite characters. Anybody know David? Y'all know David. Y'all know David slaying the giant. We're not going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the journey of the ark. Anybody know what the Ark of the Covenant is? Yes, David is taking the Ark of the Covenant and he is moving it to the city of David. And there's so much that happens on this journey in 2 Samuel 6. So if you have your word, your physical word, it's also going to be on the screen because we are very courteous. You know, we like to read the screen. So we're going to read through a lot of this scripture. We're going to take some pauses in between. But I think every one of us is going to be challenged, including ourselves. Is that all right? Is that all right? Let's start with verse 1. Then David again gathered all the elite troops in Israel, 30,000 in all. He led them to Baal of Judah to bring back the Ark of God, which bears the name of the Lord of Heaven's armies, who is enthroned between the cherubim. They placed the Ark on a new cart and brought it into Abinadab's house. Old Testament names are so hard. Abinadab's house, which was on a hill. Uzziah and Ahio, Abinadab's sons, were guiding the cart that carried the Ark of God. Ahio walked in front of the ark. David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, singing songs and playing all kinds of musical instruments, lyres, harps, tambourines, castanets, and cymbals. And so we're going to stop right there for a second because I love this last line. It says, David and all the people of Israel. It didn't say just David is celebrating before the Lord. It says David and how many? All. Not some, not the few who like to sing, not the few who are musical. It says David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord. So my first question this morning is, are you celebrating his presence? None of us want to answer that. Are you celebrating his presence? You look at the scripture, and this is the time where David, the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God, was God's presence in the Old Testament. That was the representation of God's presence. When they built the temple in the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant was in the Holy of Holies, which represented God's presence. If you read ahead in Scripture, when Jesus comes, dies on the cross, what happens to that Holy of Holies? The temple veil was split, and God's presence flooded the earth. Scripture goes to say that when two or three are gathered together in my name, there I will be also. Well, if I look at the numbers right here, that means God's presence in this place. That means when you're driving to work on a Monday morning and you ask God to fill this car with your presence, that means he's in your car. He's going to meet you where you're at. But if you look at our life, it doesn't look like a celebration every time we get into God's presence, does it? Sure doesn't look like it on some Sunday mornings. It doesn't look like it every Sunday morning. Well, that's not the song. He's off key. Mark's off key. We look and we should be celebrating God's presence. We should be celebrating not just on Sunday mornings, y'all. I'm not just talking about Sunday mornings, but I'm talking about the Monday through Friday or Saturday. When you are in his presence, you should be celebrating. You should be celebrating it. Because here's the point of being in God's presence. It's a representation that people get to see and witness his presence. Because I mean, Joe, come on. Joe, come on. Joe's a perfect example. Come on, man. Not you, Joe, but as in you as an example. I'm not talking about Joe because Joe's awesome. Hey, come up here as well. Hey, look at this. This is what celebrating the presence looks like. Can you dance? Give me a little dance. Can you raise your hands? Yeah. Can you sing? Okay, we won't let you do that. You see, hey, just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Now, Joe wants to be grumpy this morning. Joe, would you just? Could you have a fierce look in your face, like? Fierce. Here's that. Yes. All right, you can keep your hands raised. Check this out. This is the illustration I think of when I see celebrating. Who do you see worshiping in this moment right now? Joe, no. Aiden, man, you can tell. You see Aiden. You can see Aiden raising his hand. Usually when you're raising your hands, you're celebrating something. When you're singing yourself, happy birthday is a song. It's not a happy birthday to you. It's a song that you sing. That means, shouldn't our worship look like a celebration? Not a funeral? Or not a political debate? Shouldn't it look like a heat? When somebody walks in our church doors on a Sunday morning, shouldn't they see God's people in his presence all out in a celebration? Man, y'all can sit down. No, it's important, though. But then you read on in verse 6, it says, but when they arrived at the threshing floor of Nacon, the oxen stumbled, and Uzziah reached out his hand and steadied the ark of God. Then the Lord's anger was aroused against Uzziah, and God struck him dead because of this. So Uzziah died right there beside the ark of God. It's kind of morbid, isn't it? Man, trying to worship and trying to have a glorious time, and then somebody has to go and die. And David's response reflects this. David was angry because the Lord's anger had burst out against Uzziah. He named that place Perez Uzziah, which means to burst out against Uzziah. And it's still called that today. David was now afraid of the Lord, and he asked, how can I ever bring the ark of the Lord back into my care? So David decided not to move the ark of the Lord into the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom of Gath. And we're going to pause right here. I want to give you a little bit of a backstory of this dying, Uzziah dying from the ark of the Lord. You see, in Exodus, when God was commanding them to carry the ark, you know how they were supposed to carry the ark? Four priests on their shoulders. If you look at the beginning of this chapter, how are they transporting the ark? An ox on a cart. Because here's what happens sometimes. Is sometimes we let our emotion dictate our response to God because we have a lack of understanding of what he's doing. Sometimes things in the world happen. The school shooting, different things. Family, you lose family. And we don't understand what God is doing. God, why could you allow this to happen? Why? You get mad at God and you let it affect his presence. You let it affect his presence in your life. David had the same response. You know what he did? He got mad at God, and he said, we ain't taking God's presence back to the city of David. God's a murderer. I ain't doing that. We're going to let it stay over there in Gath out of fear for what the Lord wanted to do. But let me tell you, life happens, but God is still on the throne. God is still in the control. Because here's what happens. I get it. I don't, because I don't have kids. But some of you on Sunday morning, sometimes your kids make your morning kind of dumb. You know, they just won't stop asking the same question, or they've done something, they keep hitting sister or brother, and it gets you in this what? You're emotional. You're like, man, my kids this morning. And you carry that emotion into worship, and you're like, great. They better wait till after service today. They better be good kids' church. They ain't got trouble. Kids. And we carry our emotion into our worship, don't we? Can we all be honest, right? I've carried my emotion before into worship. God, I'm so mad. We let our emotions sometimes dictate our worship, and that's dangerous. Because shouldn't our worship dictate our emotion? If we serve the God of joy, the God of happiness, the God of love, the God of peace, and we serve the one who gives us these emotions, shouldn't our worship begin to dictate that? It's easy. It's hard. It's hard to carry that in when you're mad. No, he gave Bill a raise at my office, and I deserve the raise. And we carry that hurt, and we carry that hate into our worship, but our worship is supposed to be a release to God. We're supposed to let go in his presence. Because his presence is perfect. And you see, David kind of shows us what happens. Because David said, I'm done with the ark, And in verse 11, it says the ark of the Lord remained there in Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. Then King David was told, hey, the Lord has blessed Obed-Edom's household and everything he has because of the ark of God. I read that. The news got back to David. Somebody else was receiving his blessing. And somebody else was in God's presence receiving some blessings. So David went there and brought the ark of God back. Pretty easy to forgive God when you see somebody else being blessed, isn't it? And so David brought the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with what? Great celebration. Great celebration. And I understand this because this is my biggest problem. I'll be honest with you. This is the hardest thing for me is I tend to watch others. I tend to see people get blessed and say, why can't I have that blessing? And then I realize, and God spoke to me through this, is I can't look at other people's blessings and miss out on his presence in my own life. When somebody else is spending time in worship, spending time in his presence, and God's pouring out his blessings in their life, I cannot allow myself to step out of his presence and miss out on the blessings he wants to pour out in my life. It looks different for everybody. Because a lot of times is when you're in God's presence worshiping him, he reveals his blessings that you've already had. It may not be new blessings, it may be old blessings. You got food on the table. It may be blessings you never even realized. And God provided me a job through all these situations. And God provided for me here and this and that. And look, and David realized the same problem. He was missing out on God's blessing. And so when we see people getting blessed, you see, I understand, it's easy. Our first emotion is to what? Is to be jealous. Man, God must love them more than me. God must love them that, man, they worship all the time. And Tina, she worships. Tina, you are a worshiper. She worships. God must just bless her more than me. No, what the problem is we don't go into his presence with a worshipful attitude expecting the blessing. We go in desperate. God just give me that. Just give me that. I'll raise my hand at this moment. I see what you're doing. When you're in his presence, he's going to reveal how to worship him. He's going to reveal his word in your life. He's going to reveal it. And it's not just on Sunday morning, y'all. If you're thinking it's just about Sunday morning worship, you're missing the whole point. See, God's presence is an everyday thing. It's not just a Sunday morning from 10 to 11 30. It's every single day coming into his presence. Coming, God, I receive your word this morning. God, I receive your blessing. God, I receive it. A lot of times we like to stay outside of God's presence because I don't want to experience it. I don't want the feeling of being told or being feeling of that. I don't want to feel that. I don't want to know. But let me tell you, when you go into his presence wherever you're at, you know you can bring God's presence in your car. You can bring God's presence to your work. And you can bring God's presence over your household. You can bring it. He gets it. When you bring God's presence in your place of worship, let me tell you, the blessings will be there. It may not be the blessings that you're seeing other people receive, because those blessings aren't for you. God wants to pour out his blessings in your life, but he's asking us to worship. He's asking us to be in his presence. To be in his presence. Be in his presence. Be present in his presence. And you see, after this, and this is fun, because David, I love David. Man, David is just makes me smile. In verse 13, it says, after the men who were carrying the ark, so he's taking it from Obed-Edom's house, after the men who were carrying the ark of the Lord had gone, 6 steps, scripture is very specific, 6 steps, look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, David's like, stop, hey, stop the ship. We got to stop the ship for a moment. Because here's what David said. He sacrificed a bull and fattened a calf. And David, man, David danced before the Lord with all of his might, wearing a priestly garment. Priestly garment is not wearing very much. Let me put it that way. Verse 15. So David and all the people, did y'all hear that again? Did y'all hear that? David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of a ram's horn. Let me read that again. I don't know if y'all read the scripture with me, because I said shouts of joy. Shouts of joy and the blowing of a ram's horns. That means, you got to look at this scripture, because I don't know David personally, but I don't know anybody who wants to dance almost naked. I don't know anybody that they're saying, God, if God calls me to dance naked, I can't wait to do it. But David, listen, y'all got to get this. Worship is not about our preference, it's about his presence. That's what this tells me, that worship is essentially all about his presence, not our preference. That means when you're in presence of God, and he calls you to dance, well, you get a little step in your step and start dancing. That means when you get in his presence and you're worshiping with other believers, it's okay to go, thank you, God, for what you've done for me. It's okay to shout. It's okay to sing it out. You may be on key the whole song, but God hears a beautiful sound of worship. Of worship. Well, that's not me. That's not my personality. Listen, it's not about your preference. When you're in the presence of God, it's not about your preference. You don't have to wait for the perfect worship song to begin to dance, to begin to shout, to begin to scream for joy, to begin to lift his name up with praise. You don't have to wait for the perfect worship song, because worship's not about the song. It's about worshiping him and his presence. At this point in time, they're just dancing and shouting for joy. They're making a joyful noise with their mouth. They ain't playing the instruments anymore, y'all. They're marching. Listen, we're in the presence of God. And people know because I'm in the presence of God. I'm shouting. I'm singing. But I don't do the shout thing. Listen, I don't do that. But Scripture is very clear that worship is so much more than just a song. It's so much more than hearing the guitar play gently in the background. It's so much more than a perfect, written masterpiece of music. It's so much more than that. Worship is us fully sacrificing our pride, fully sacrificing and saying, God, you're worthy of all the glory. God, you're worthy of all the honor. God, you're worthy of my praise, Lord. I know I've messed up. I know I've been through some stuff, but God, your love is you. You're worthy of it. You're worthy of my shouts. God, I like to be quiet, but God, I just want to shout for you because you are my joy, God. Lord, I don't really know how to dance. I never took dance lessons, but God, if you want me to dance, I'll get a little excited to dance. God, if you want me to sing at the top of my lungs so I have no more voice, God, I will sing. I will sing. We're all called to worship. David and all of Israel. Not just Mark and some of LFA. No, Mark is a worship leader. He gets to deliver us into the presence of God. He gets to make the musical sounds. But you, as individuals, are the ones who go into the worship. Yeah, he makes the pretty music. That sounds good. I like it. He makes the sounds. That sounds good. But every single one of us is what makes corporate worship worship. Every single one of us stepping into God's presence. Because God's presence in this place this morning, let me tell you. You may not feel it yet, but let me tell you, you will. You will. God's presence is in this place. And he wants to have that moment with you. But here's the kicker. This is the part of I kind of love about this verse the most. And at the end of this verse, there's a confrontation. As David is delivering the Ark of God into the city of David, he has this interaction with Michal, the daughter of Saul. Saul was the previous king. It says this in verse 16. But as the Ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked down from her window. And she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord. And she was filled with contempt for them. Some of us do that. I can't believe the person is dancing in church this morning. She's making a fool of herself. He's making a fool of himself. But in verse 17 it says, they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the special tent and peace offerings to the Lord. 18. He had finished his sacrifices. David blessed the people in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies. 19. Then he gave to every Israelite man and woman in the crowd a loaf of bread, a cake of dates and a cake of raisins. Then all the people returned to their homes. Verse 20, when David returned home to bless his own family, Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him. Nobody likes confrontation, so I just know this is not going well. And she said in disgust, how distinguished the king of Israel looked today. shamelessly exposing himself to the servant girls like any vulgar person might do. And then David, being David, retorted to Michelle, "I was dancing before the Lord, who chose me above your father and all his family. So I celebrate the Lord. Yes, and I'm willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. But those servants girls you mentioned will indeed think I am distinguished." So Michelle, the daughter of Saul, remained childless throughout her life. "I was dancing before the Lord," David said. Many of us get worried about what people will think if I go dance before the Lord. Many of us get nervous to even raise our hands in church. Because what is my coworker, or what is my wife, or what is my sons and daughters going to think of me if I choose to worship the Lord? Because you see, the enemy wants to send distractions to disrupt your worship. He wants to send a Michal into your life. "Listen, I know you love to dance, but we don't do that in this church. But in your heart, you should know who your confidence is." And we talked about that in worship. You know who your confidence is. If you know who Jesus is in your life, and you know where your worship comes from, let me tell you, church, I don't care what distraction, I don't care what people think of me, if I am worshiping and dancing and worshiping my Lord in his presence, it doesn't matter what they think of me, because I know who I belong to. Do you? That's what worship's about. It's about letting go. So what if I dance a little bit? So what if I shout? That's not my personality. You may think it is, because all you hear is me through a microphone, but I'm the biggest introvert you've ever met. But my worship, God deserves all the glory. God, when he breaks my heart, you won't see me at a concert worshiping more than what I do on a Sunday morning, I can tell you that much right now. You won't see me cheering at a football game more than I do on a Sunday morning. You won't. I promise you won't. Because he deserves all the glory. He deserves all the honor. And don't let a distraction stop you from worshiping our God fully. Don't let a distraction, don't let people's thoughts of you, because you may be a little bit undignified to dance. It may be undignified to sing off key. It may be undignified to shout during a worship song. But let me tell you, if you're bringing it to God right now in this place, it's okay. God sees your praise. God sees the glory. And here's the coolest part about all of this. In Psalm 150, it says, "Let everything that has praise the Lord." Everything. That means none of us, not one person in this place, is excused from worshiping our Savior. Not one person in this place is dismissed early to not worship our Savior. Not one of us has non-ability to lift up our Savior. And so I'm going to ask everybody to stand up as we close today. And I budgeted plenty of time because, listen, I do not want you to leave this place without finding the source of your joy, source of your love through his worship and his presence. Some of you are great worshipers. I'm going to ask you to go a little bit further than your normal worship. Some of you who are Joe, you to get out of your comfort zone a little bit. Get out of your comfort zone of, I don't know if I can raise my hands. People might judge me. People aren't thinking about you. They're thinking about the Savior. Don't be distracted. Don't say it's not your personality. Because if I just read this scripture correctly, everybody was shot with joy. Everybody was dancing. I doubt there was all the same kind of people. I'm sure it was all kinds of people just like us. That means church right now. Some of you need to step out of your seat because you're distracted, and you need to find a place to worship our Savior. And that's what we're going to do to close this service. You may